Vor der Kaserne, vor dem großen Tor, stand eine Laterne und steht sie noch davor. So wollen wir uns da wiedersehen bei der Laterne.
A week or so ago, a friend of mine sent me an email in which he touched a poem, suggesting that I might like to load it onto my YouTube channel. He also mentioned that the poem had an extraordinary backstory. I liked the poem and decided to check out on its history. And indeed, the events surrounding the poem were fascinating and extraordinarily moving. I found the whole thing quite profound. Whilst the poem itself is really very pleasing, the practical effect that this diminutive, petal-soft literary work had on the historical events during which it came to prominence, truly stirring. Going way beyond the emotional feelings that might be generated by just reading the poem, to the degree that I resolved to record and tell the story as it had come through to me. The circumstances to which I'm referring were part of what is perhaps as catastrophic a man-made event as any in history. World War II, September 1939. Many of you will know of, but not remember, the time. I do. I was a couple of years old when World War II broke out. And I remember certain events. For instance, I remember one evening a knock, a tap on the window of our flat. It was an air raid warning, saying that your curtains are not fully drawn. Please close them. Now I ask you, this is in deepest, darkest South Africa, Springs. Air raids? Come on. Anyway, true story. Now, there are three specific elements central to the story I'm narrating. A man, a woman, and a poem. The man was Leo Marx, the woman Violetta Saba, the poem, the life that I have. Leo Marx, born 1920, son of a bookseller, and significant to our story. Marx, a genius to be, demonstrates that gift by learning to decipher the coded prices which his father entered on the inside cover of the books he was selling. Age 8, Marx breaks the code. Violetta Rienne Elizabeth Bushell, born 1921, daughter of a British Army truck driver posted to northern France, and a French woman, a dressmaker, seamstress. Violetta's parents moved to England, maybe mid-20s, and Violetta was left with her brother in France with an aunt. That's another significant event in our story. Violetta, by the time she was 11 and came to England, had fully developed, or to the degree that an 11-year-old can, her French mother tongue. Stuck. Had she been since age, say, 1, 2, or 3, perhaps her French ability, the language, would have evaporated. Had it done so, history would have been not as it was. Who knows? I've made at least 3, 4, 5 attempts to get this reading up on YouTube. Each occasion, I was simply not happy that I'd captured the essence of what had turned me on to the story. In fact, I couldn't quite put my finger on why the story had got to me as it did. So each time I discarded the reading. Finally, on researching a bit further, it clicked what it was that had eluded me. I saw now clearly what I previously had only subconsciously registered. Violetta was an extraordinarily beautiful woman. She reminded me of my mother. She too was beautiful. But in addition, and perhaps more importantly, these two women had both each been subject to an event which presented them both with a major, though different, problem. And way back then, almost at the same time, they rose to the occasion. My mother divorced my father. She was left with 2 children, but she determined to see that my brother and I were educated and protected. As the secretary, she would have struggled. So she set about becoming a lawyer, one of only 5 women lawyers in South Africa. Violetta's problems were somewhat more drastic. But she too got up and got going in the most dramatic fashion. Now, back in the early 40s, 80 years ago, these two good ladies were applying themselves much as modern feminists would have it. I've always been conscious and admired this quality in my mum, and here in this story, Violetta commits herself with an almost unbelievable fortitude. Now, Violetta, having arrived in London in her teens, was an energetic, lively lass. She loved skating, gymnastics, cycling. As a French speaker, she was seen as somewhat exotique by her peers. And, again significantly, her father had taught her to use a gun. She would shoot. History was being wrought. So now we fast forward. September 1939, England declares war on Germany. The early months of the war are pretty uneventful in England and become known as the Phoney War. However, heavy-duty conflict erupts all too soon, and it's not long before the British are driven off and rescued from the beaches of Dunkirk. In the meantime, Leo Marx, 20 years old, is conscripted and soon posted to the Secret Service, the SOE. It is the Special Operations Executive. Its business is to train secret agents in conducting sabotage and reconnaissance in Europe and elsewhere. Marx, from the start, has his detractors, but his genius soon manifests itself, and he quickly rises to become a formidable figure in the organization. Amongst other things, he reforms the whole process of the how coding and encrypting messages should be carried out. In 1940, Violetta too gets involved in assisting the war effort. Initially, she joins the Land Army, but soon changes jobs and returns to London to work in an arms factory. During this period, one day, her mum sends her to Trafalgar Square. It's Bastille Day, and the French are having their celebratory parade there. Her mission is to bring home a lonely, homesick French soldier for dinner. The lucky fella turns out to be one Etienne Szabo, a Hungarian member of the French Foreign Legion. They fall in love, and before long, they marry. They only have, however, 1 week's honeymoon before Etienne is posted to Africa on active duty. Violetta continues her vigorous commitment to the war effort. She works during the Blitz as a telephone operator with the General Post Office. She gets bored of this and joins the ATS and is trained as a predictor, predict where aeroplanes are, at an anti-aircraft battery. A job she does well and enthusiastically. Etienne returns home from Africa on leave, but not for long. He's soon posted back to North Africa. Violetta discovers she's pregnant. She gives birth to a baby daughter, Tanya, June 1942. Placing her daughter with a childminder, Violetta returns to work at an aircraft factory in London. But sadly, now she gets the news that Etienne has been killed at the Battle of El Alamein, October 1942. He never sees his daughter. It's thought that the fact of his death drives Violetta to be even more committed to the war effort, and she accepts an offer to join the SOE. After passing security checks on the 1st of July 1943, she selected for training as a field agent, and on the 10th of July she's commissioned as a section leader in the First Aid Nursing Yeomanry, the Fannies. The Fannies are a civilian service which could be and is used as a cover for SOE female agents. And so begins her training as a spy. Tough and rigorous. These are some of the skills she has to master. Fieldcraft, night and daylight navigation, weapons training, demolition, escape and evasion, uniform recognition, communications, cryptography. I'm exhausted just thinking about it. Parachute jumping. On her first parachute jump, she breaks an ankle and has to recuperate. But she returns and passes. She prepares now for her first mission, but it's postponed. The opportunity is taken by the SOE to send her for further training. So fate now plays yet another hand. For it is here that she gets to benefit from Codemaster Leo Marx's reformation of the coding system. At the time of Marx joining the COE, a well-known poem might be selected and memorized by an agent and used to encrypt the messages he's going to send. Marx quickly realizes that well-known poems are a weakness. The Germans are well-educated and literate. All they have to do is crack, say, a couple of words in a poem. Example, to be or not to be. It doesn't take a genius to realize that the code is now broken, the entire document. To remedy this weakness, Marx makes up a poem. It might be nonsense or doggerel. Either way, he'll give a different one to each agent, making the enemy decoder's job much more difficult. However, there is a poem that Marx had written earlier in memory of a woman whom he loved and who had been killed in a car crash. The poem is called The Life That I Have. It is the poem at the center of the story. It is the poem he gives to Violetta. It is his only poem out of many he wrote that still remains known and is critically recognized. On the 5th of April, Violetta, as a member of the SOE circuit salesman, is sent off on her first mission. She's parachuted into northern France near Dieppe. Her mission is to try and assess, amongst other things, the suspected damage to the circuit salesman to which she belongs. It is thought correctly to have been exposed. It is, in fact, found to be beyond repair. Further, she is to reconnoiter and gain information on armament factories, or any factories for that matter, that are used in the German war effort. She does it to great effect, pinpointing many factories as future bombing targets for the RAF. Extraordinarily, before returning to Britain, she travels to Paris to brief a colleague, and whilst there, finds time and the nerve to go shopping for, amongst other things, some clothing for her daughter. In the middle of German-occupied France. She returns to London on the 30th of April and is promoted later to the rank of ensign and is now a member of the new circuit salesman too. 6th of June, 1944, D-Day is underway. The Allies land in France and the path to final victory lies ahead. On the 8th of June, 44, Violetta and three others are parachuted deep into the middle of France near Limoges. Their mission, to coordinate the badly led Limousin French Marquis, coordinate them in sabotaging communications and so inhibit the Germans in halting the Allies' advance. Things don't go well. For starters, the Germans have forbidden anyone to use motorized vehicles. Obvious reasons why. Philippe Liouve, in command of the group, decides to send his courier Violetta as liaison officer to assist the Marquis of an adjacent district. 10th of June, Violetta, instead of travelling by the safer method of cycling, bicycling, almost insanely travels by car, driven by a young Marquis, Jacques Dufour. Why? They stop to pick up Jean Barrio, another Marquis. Violetta's lightly dressed, flat shoes, no stockings, armed with a Sten gun and 8 magazines. By the way, it's also believed that she sprained her ankle again on this jump into France. Now, it comes as no great surprise that the group arrive at a German roadblock ahead of them. Barrio, unarmed, leaps out and legs it. He tells cohorts, his pals, about the situation. Dufour and Violetta, they engage the Germans, but reinforcements arrive and they have to run into a field up a hill, into a wood where she falls, having sprained her ankle yet again. Dufour tries to help her. She says, go, which he does. She climbs behind, or climbs the hill up behind an apple tree and fires at her pursuers. They believe she may have killed a young German, but the ammunition runs out and she's captured. The local SS take her, give her some heavy duty torture and questioning, but the Allies are coming, so they send her off to France, to the headquarters, where again she's abused and tortured by her captors for 4 days. They know who she is. She tells them nothing. With the Allies approaching, they ship her and other SOE agents on a train. She's shackled to one of them, sending her off to Ravensbrück. Little, if any, food, virtually no water. And after a horrendous 18-day journey, they arrive at Ravensbrück. Here, it was intended that they execute them all as members of the Secret Service. They are killed so they don't divulge all the horrible, illegal treatment they've had from the Nazis. Violetta remains in captivity through the winter until February 1945. They all endure hard labor, starvation, rations, pitiful clothing, no blankets, brutal treatment. Notwithstanding, Violetta tries to hold faith that she's going to escape. She works at keeping others' morale up and indeed saves the life of one poor soul, an old lady who'd been injected with gangrene as an experiment. It's all to no avail. About the 5th of February, 1945, she and two others are maneuvered towards Execution Alley. The other two are disabled and are carried on stretchers. Violetta, just able to walk, kneels down, holds their hands for comfort, and all of them are shot in the back of the head with a revolver. She's 23. Her grave has never been found. She's posthumously awarded the George Cross, some years later given to her daughter. Why did Leo Marx give Violetta that precious gift of his poem? He described her a dark-haired slip of mischief. A girl of 5'3" tall, she was average in most of her tests when training as an agent. No shame there, much like the rest of us. What she did have was an overabundance of courage, somewhat more than the rest of us. I speak for myself. It is said that everybody loved Violetta, including the entire SOE. She was a joyous soul with an infectious laugh and an engaging Cockney accent, who constantly communicated her zest for life. I reckon Leo Marx simply loved her. There's a film called Carve Her Name with Pride. It's on the same story. In it, a lover is introduced for Violetta, and it is he that writes the poem and reads it to her. As I see it, it's just a dramatic, sentimental ploy. For me, I prefer the real story. Marx was asked if he minded them using the poem in the story in that fashion, and he said, okay. I think that's beautifully cool, so unpretentious. So here we have a cool genius, a cool heroine, and a cool heartfelt poem. The life that I have is all that I have, and the life that I have is yours. The love that I have of the life that I have is yours and yours and yours. A sleep I shall have, a rest I shall have, yet death will be but a pause for the peace of my years in the long green grass. Will be yours and yours and yours.